Okay. So we're very happy to have Alberto Zaffaroni from Milano for a set of lectures on supersymmetric localization and black holes, black hole microstate counting. So Alberto has 2 hours, but we'll take a 5-minute break after 55 minutes or so. So please.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. And in these 4 lectures, I will discuss essentially an application of localization to a counting problem for black holes, in particular microstates of asymptotically ADS black holes. So there will be a mixture of localization that I will review briefly in the first lecture. And as you know, localization is a very powerful tool to evaluate exact partition function in quantum field theory, and has been used in the last 10 years to compute all kind of partition function in all kind of dimensions for all kind of purposes. The lecture will be a mixture of localization, so quantum field theory technique, that I will address today, essentially, in the first 2 hours. The first hour will be a general review of how it works. The second hour will be a specific example, and obviously I choose the example that is fitted to the application to black hole later on. Another big issue at the end is holography, because in the application part to black hole, I will discuss asymptotically ADS black hole. Since there is a asymptotic region which is anti the sitter, you can already imagine that I will be counting microstates of the black hole, so the guy that are responsible for the entropy, with a dual field theory computation. So there is an anti the sitter, there should be a conformal field theory which is dual to it. And I will take luckily enough, people have found an interesting class of black hole that are asymptotic to ADS 4 times S7, where we know perfectly well what is the conformal field theory. The conformal field theory is this famous ABJM model. I will briefly review it in the second part of these lectures. So we know what is the dual field theory. We need to do a field theory computation for the counting of microstates. And here I will be using holography. Finally, the third topic I already mentioned is the microstate of black holes. And here you know that one of the great success of string theory, this is more than 20 years ago, it was 96, was a microscopic counting for the entropy of asymptotically flat black hole. I will discuss it briefly in the third lecture, and I will not discuss much the asymptotically flat story. It's a standard piece of the history of string theory, but probably you know how it works. It's a computation done essentially using the Cardy formula that evaluates the asymptotic growth states in a conformal field theory. The asymptotically flat, asymptotically ADS black hole is a completely different story. In a sense, they are simpler because they are supposed to have a quantum field theory dual that describes the full black hole. So the natural thing to evaluate here is some partition function for states in the conformal field theory, but in a certain sense, while the asymptotically flat story is now well understood, people, including Ashok, made marvelous check even beyond the large charge limit. The story for asymptotically anti the sitter black hole is much less understood. I will discuss here an example, which is ADS4. So in 4 dimensions, these are magnetically charged black hole. And as I will discuss in the 4th lecture, using localization, you can actually compare and match the entropy of the black hole with a field theory computation. But for example, there is a class of black hole, rotating black hole in five dimensions, which are supposed to correspond just to states of n equal 4 super Young Mills, and up to the moment, no one is able to give a clear explanation of why the entropy that you compute from gravity is that particular value. So there is no, at the moment, field theory computation that can reproduce that. So there are many topics involved in this story, and the story is indeed a nice intersection of many different things. Holography, localization, and black hole physics. And in this four lecture, I'll try to give you a general overview. At a certain point, things will become technical, so I'm not planning to give all the technical details of how it works in this specific case, localization, how you evaluate one loop determinants, and so on. You can find all this information in the reference that I'll give you during the lectures. And if you want more details, you can stop me at any time or use the discussion section and so on. Okay, so essentially the first lecture will be devoted to a review of, brief review, just the general idea about quantum field theory and localization. Okay, these ideas of localization apply to the computation of Euclidean partition function for supersymmetric field theory. And essentially, the data is very old, and in order to be effective, localization required essentially two things. First of all, you do your computation in Euclidean. That's not a big deal. You can always Vic rotate a Lorentzian theory. But you also do the computation in Euclidean signature on a compact manifold. Compact manifold is required to provide essentially an infrared cutoff for your computation. So you first need a Euclidean compact manifold. I'll try to write in big letters, but obviously at a certain point I'll forget, so stop me when the letters will become invisible to the last row of the room, okay? And the compact manifold, yeah, okay, it's needed to provide an infrared cutoff to make the partition function well-defined. And the other crucial ingredient is a fermionic symmetry, a supercharge that is square to zero, or more generally, square to a bosonic symmetry of your theory. So with these two ingredients, essentially, what you can do, and I'll tell you in this first lecture, is to evaluate a path integral using a saddle point approximation. And essentially, what you can compute in this way is the exact partition function of your theory on the manifold M, and also the vacuum expectation value of various supersymmetric observables. Now, there are a few questions to discuss before coming to how localization works. And the first obvious question is what kind of manifold you can take here. The point is that not all manifolds support supersymmetry, in the sense that if you have a Lagrangian, usually you write your Lagrangian in Minkowski space, you have supersymmetric transformation. This is a rigid supersymmetry, so it's a quantum field theory, gauge theory. So you have a spinorial parameter, which is a constant, and you write your supersymmetric transformation. Then you can always rotate to the Euclidean, modulo subtleties, because as you probably know, fermions are very different in Lorentzian and Euclidean signature. So the Euclidean continuation is already a subtle thing, but there are ways of doing that. So you can go to the Euclidean, and then you can try to put the theory on a compact manifold. At this point, troubles may arise, because it's not obvious at all that your Lagrangian is still invariant under the same transformation that you wrote in flat space. And the reason is very simple. Usually, to check the invariant of the Lagrangian, you are free to perform integration by parts many times, typically. And when you are on a curved manifold, you must be careful because your derivatives must become covariant derivatives. Covariant derivatives does not commute anymore, so typically the methods fail. You write your Lagrangian, you try to keep a constant spinor, and you fail miserably in most cases. So you need to at least to deform a little bit your Lagrangian and your supersymmetry transformation. This method works in many cases, but not in all, in the sense that not all manifold can support a supersymmetric Lagrangian. The basic examples are very old, end of the 80s. These are the topological field theory introduced by Witten. They work very well, for example, for n equal to 2 gauge theory in 4 dimensions. They work very well in 2 dimensions, if you have at least 2,2 supersymmetry. In 2 dimensions, these are typically called twist A or twist B, and has been used in the topological business as a tool for computing geometric invariants of the manifold. Donaldson invariants in 4 dimensions, Gromov-Witten invariants of Calabi-Yau in 2 dimensions. So this is a possibility, and you will see how it fits in this framework later on. And another obvious possibility is the following. If you have a super conformal field theory, you can always make a conformal transformation since your action is invariant. So if you start with flat space and you do a conformal transformation, you can still write a Lagrangian on the conformal transform metric. This, for example, works very well for spheres in all dimensions. And indeed, the recent triggering of interest for localization came from the work of Pestun in 2007, where he took this point of view of using n equal 4 superior mills and its deformations, make a conformal transformation from flat space to a sphere, and compute the partition function. Now, topological field theory and spheres works very well. In the middle, there are a lot of different possibilities. In some nice dimension, with some nice number of supersymmetry, all the possibilities have been classified in the last few years. The point is the following. If you want your supersymmetric Lagrangian on a manifold, you have two possible ways. The first is the obvious one, try and error. You know what you have to do. You use the flat space transformation. They fail. You use another method in order to construct the invariant Lagrangian. This method is obviously not general. Sometimes it's simpler than the most complicated one, and most of the example on spheres and other manifold can be actually written using a try and error method. So you can use essentially Noether method, or there is a more general method that allows also for partial classification, at least, and this is the method of coupling to supergravity. I will briefly review this because it gives a flavor of what kind of constraint you have to put on the method. The application of this idea, which is also very old, to the recent development is due to Festuccia and Seiberg in 2011. And the idea is simple enough. So you start with a rigid Lagrangian. Rigid Lagrangian for your fields, and typically if you have a gauge theory, you have a bunch of scalars, a bunch of fermions and gauge field, and these are invariants under some rigid transformation. This obviously depends on dimensions and number of supersymmetry and so on. So I will write some schematic transformation law. Obviously, the scalar must transform into the fermion. Typically, the fermion transform back to a derivative of the scalar, and so on. The idea is the idea of coupling to supergravity is the following. You actually take your Lagrangian written in for a flat metric, and you couple it to a gravity multiplet, more precisely a supersymmetric gravity multiplet, which contains the metric, the gravitino, and other fields. Is again, the dots refer to the fact that I don't want to commit myself to a particular dimension, a particular type of supersymmetry, so they are different according to the number of supersymmetry and the dimension, but certainly they contain the metric and the gravitino, and you write essentially a supergravity Lagrangian. Okay, so it seems that, I don't know if you can hear me well when I'm on top of the black core. I hear a big noise here, so I hope that you can hear me. So you write a supergravity Lagrangian. Luckily enough, this has been done for us in the years by many people, including some in this audience, so we know how to couple matter to supergravity in most cases. And this new Lagrangian will be invariant under transformation which generalizes the transformation of the rigid theory, but with the spinor that also depends on the position in space-time, and you will also have transformation for the gravity field. It's easier to write the transformation for the Fermion of your theory, and typically this transformation is something like that. Again, this depends on dimensions, number of supersymmetries, and other things. So I just wrote G mu nu as E mu A E A nu. And now the spinor depends on the position. In a sense, what you are doing is a gauging of the original symmetry of the theory. The original symmetry was invariant under translation, Lorentz transformation, supersymmetry transformation, and these guys are gauging these symmetries. So that obviously your Lagrangian will contain various terms. You have the original Lagrangian, which will be shifted by coupling, which have the schematic form at a linearized order. The stress energy tensor of the original theory will couple to the metric. The gravitino will couple to the fermionic supercurrent. And then there will be other terms that give a completion of this Lagrangian. The logic is that you don't really need gravity here. You want to write a theory on curved space-time. So once you have your supergravity Lagrangian, you can go back. So you can try to freeze the gravity modes in a supersymmetric way. Freezing the gravity modes means that I don't want that they fluctuate, so you can, for example, take the Planck mass and send it to infinity in order to freeze the fields, but you don't want to send them to zero. So what you want is to freeze these fields to a background, so G mu nu m is the metric on the compact manifold that you chose. You don't want fermions around, so you set the gravitino to zero. And at this point, you have a Lagrangian where these guys here are background. This is zero. And this Lagrangian will be supersymmetric if the configuration, this ansatz that you are making is compatible with the transformation of supersymmetry that you wrote. So you have to check that the transformation of supersymmetry are satisfied by this background. But the transformation of supersymmetry contains a part that acts on the original fields. This you want to keep. This will be your transformation of the matter field in the curved background, and you want to take the transformation of the gravity multiplet and to set to check that the transformation takes this configuration and leave it invariant. Now, there are a modulo of fields that I haven't written. There is obviously a transformation of the metric that, however, is proportional to the gravitino. So if I set all the fermions in the gravity multiplet to zero, this will be automatically zero. So you can freeze the metric to whatever value you want. But then, obviously, there is the important one, which is the transformation of the fermion in the theory. Again, this transformation I haven't written before because there's a crucial point. This depends on the dimension, the number of supersymmetry that you have, and many other things. So you're certainly familiar with many different types of supergravity. Typically, they always contain a covariant derivative of your spinor plus other things. Okay? The other things depends on the dimension, number of supersymmetry. This object, the left-hand side of this transformation is not automatically zero in general. And you need to solve this equation in order to find the form of the spinor that allow to define supersymmetry in curved space. So typically here, when you want to write this partition function, you need a particular spinor which depends on the coordinate on the manifold that satisfies a differential equation of this form. Now, to the purpose of understanding what manifold supports supersymmetry, the problem is the following. You have a differential equation for a spinor, and you need to understand if this can be solved or not. Well, in general, this...
So, the metric that this is, does it have to be a solution of the full supergravity equations?
No, because you just want that the Lagrangian is invariant under a set of transformation. So it's enough to check the transformation of supersymmetry, not the equation of motion of the full Lagrangian. Just a trick, okay? Don't think that you are embedding the theory. It's not necessary to think that you are embedding a theory in some supergravity or string theory. Just a trick to understand how things transform under supersymmetry. So the point is that this equation is not in general solvable in all possible dimensions. Now, in the last few years, this kind of equation have been classified in various dimensions. Let me just give you an example just to understand how it works in general. The most studied case is the four dimension with one supersymmetry, four theories with an R symmetry. Now, what you can do is the following. You couple to a relevant supergravity. And again, here, the business becomes immediately complicated because there are so many supergravities. For example, in four dimensions, there is the old minimal supergravity. There is the new minimal supergravity. There are many of them. And for example, in a particular case, which is the old minimal, I will not use this result later, but let me give you just an example, minimal. The gravity multiplet contains the graviton, the gravitino, and there are also two extra vectors because typically you have to include auxiliary fields in your game, and v mu is actually a one form that must satisfy an extra constraint. And this particular equation looks like the variation of the gravitino is the mu epsilon plus I v mu gamma mu nu plus v mu minus a mu epsilon equals zero. So this is what you get from supergravity. So the question is if you can find a solution of this equation. Now, the point is that typically a gravity multiplet contains many other fields beside the gravity and the gravitino. So here you are free to choose other backgrounds, for example, for these extra fields. Each different background, if compatible with the transformation of supersymmetry, give you a well-defined supersymmetric Lagrange. So here the point is, can you find vectors on a four-dimensional metric such that you can solve this equation? Well, equations with the spinors have this property. Not always they can be solved. For example, if you ask, can I find a constant spinor on a sphere, the simplest two-sphere? Well, the answer is no. There is no constant spinor. So the equation, there is no covariantly constant spinor equation on a sphere. So if you want to solve the simplest equation where you have no such term on the sphere, you can't. And the reason, it's too technical to explain, but for the sphere is the fact that the commutator of two covariant derivatives is actually proportional to the curvature. So if you have a covariant with a constant spinor, you apply another covariant derivative, you get zero on one side, you get the curvature on the other side. So the point is that, not in general, equations for spinor are not necessarily solved on any manifold. So the question here, if you want to write a supersymmetric Lagrangian for a four-dimensional theory with n equal 1 supersymmetry, is the following. Can you choose background field, the metric, and this extra guy such that you can solve this equation? Well, you have to work a little bit to understand if this can be done. This has been studied, and this particular equation the solution of this particular equation has been classified in the last few years. I will briefly give you the result just for completeness. If you choose to solve this equation for one spinor of one chirality, you discover that, for example, your manifold, if you take it Euclidean, which is what we want to do, must be complex. Otherwise, you must be a complex manifold. Otherwise, you cannot solve this equation. These kind of things are completely different according to the signature of spacetime. So, for example, even if not relevant for this series of lecture, you want to solve the same equation in Lorentzian signature. Again, you have a constraint, but this time the constraint is different. M must have a null killing vector. So typically, the solution of differential equation for fermions give you constraint on geometry of the manifold. This first result is due to various people, Dumitrescu, Festuccia, Cyber, myself actually, Clare, Tomasiello. And the second one, the Lorentzian, is again myself with Cassani and Martelli. This is just to give you a flavor of the kind of equation that you need to solve. You can change supergravity, you can change dimension, and every time you get different Lagrangians and different constraints. You can be a slightly more general and write an equation that in principle should work in all possible cases if you take a conformal field theory. So if you take a super conformal field theory, what you can do is the following. Now a super conformal field theory has a Lorentz group, which is enhanced to the superconformal group, so it's much bigger. The supersymmetries, as you know, are doubled. There are supersymmetry and superconformal, conformal supersymmetries. They are usually called Q and S, and the conformal group usually require to have extra bosonic R-symmetries. These bosonic R-symmetries transform in some way your supercharges. Whenever the theory is conformal, you can couple to another type of supergravity, which is conformal supergravity. Again, the form, the splittest form depends on the dimension, the number of supersymmetry, and so on. But certainly, you are gauging the stress energy tensor, the supersymmetry charge, and also the R symmetry in your theory. So in this gravity, there are fields that are gauging the R symmetry. So you have extra vector fields. And the point is that when you do this, essentially, at the linearized level, what you are doing is to add coupling to the stress energy tensor, the supercurrent, and the R symmetry currents of your theory, plus completion. And the point is that in this kind of supergravity, the variation of the gravitino has a simpler and more universal form. Indeed, can be written always in these terms. There is a covariant derivative. There is the R symmetry that acts on the spinor. And there is a second term here, which depends on a second spinor. So this is a structure which is slightly simpler than this one, because it depends on the metric, on the R symmetry background fields that are something that you usually want to know how they behave. And the point, the reason why you have two spinors is that the number of supersymmetry are doubled, so in a, superconformal field theory. So say epsilon plus has to do with the supersymmetry, epsilon minus with the conformal supersymmetry. So you need this equation that depends on two spinors. You need to find the spinors epsilon plus and epsilon minus. But in this case, luckily enough, if you want to set this to zero, you see immediately that one spinor is easily derived with respect to the other. Take this equation, take a contraction with gamma mu. Gamma mu give you the dimension of space-time, and epsilon minus is gamma mu contracted with this guy. So you can eliminate this and write the equation in a simplest form, which is the following. let me call this derivative with a capital I on top. So whenever in this lecture you see an A on top of the derivative, it means that it's a covariant derivative with respect to the metric, but also with respect to the other gauge field under which the fermion is charged. And the equation can be easily written in this form. Gamma mu just for one spinor. And this guy should be zero. Now, this equation is simple enough. It depends only on a spinor, and is also an equation that is well known also to mathematicians. It's called the conformal killing equation. Why it's called the conformal killing equation? Because it's invariant under conformal transformation, as should be because my starting point was a superconformal field theory. So this equation is somehow simpler than this one. It means all the story about auxiliary field. It essentially is somehow more universal because all solution of this kind of transformation are also solution of this. The reason is the following. Actually, as well known by supergravity people, most of the Poincaré supergravity have been constructed
Alberto, in the just for completion, all minima, that is new minima.
Oh, sorry, you are perfectly right. Thank you. Apologize. This is new minima. An efficient way of constructing supergravity is the following. First, you gauge the superconformal group, so you get something much bigger than what you want, and then you freeze the superconformal group to the Poincaré transformation just by fixing. Typically, you add some vector multiplet that breaks superconformal invariance. So most of the Poincaré theory can be obtained going through this step. You first go here and then go back by a gauge fixing. This means, and you can check explicitly for this equation, that all solutions of this equation are all, is also a solution of this. So essentially, the guy that I put in a box there is an equation that should be satisfied by a spinor on your manifold in order to have supersymmetry. Again, I'm cheating a little bit because if you increase, if you change dimension, if you increase the number of supersymmetry, you typically have other spinors in the theory. You have, beside the gravitino, you have other guys, the dilatino, and so on. So you have to put extra constraint. But that equation will be always there. So let me take this and give you a few examples where you can have supersymmetry. I'll give you three of them, and then in the second lecture we will discuss in detail one of them. And possibility, the first obvious possibility is the following. I need to find a manifold where I have a spinor that solves this equation. So here there is a covariant derivative. Here there is a covariant derivative multiplied by gamma matrices. Obvious possibility is suppose that you have a manifold with a covariantly constant spinor. So a spinor that are annihilated by the covariant derivative, which may include some extra fields, like, for example, a background for their symmetry. This is a covariantly constant spinor. And this essentially defines what in the literature is called a topological twist, a topological field theory, the original example by Witten. So the question is, how can I find manifold where there are covariantly constant spinor? I told you before that if you just take a sphere, you set a mu equal to zero, there is no covariantly constant spinor on the sphere. So the sphere is excluded, it's not in this game, if you set A to zero. However, if you write explicitly this expression, clearly this expression is as the schematic, the form where this is the R-symmetry field. So this is the form of your equation. Now the topological twist works in this way. If you are able to cancel these two terms altogether and reduce your equation to a simplest one, you can solve it by taking epsilon constant. And when can you do this trick? Well, essentially, if you see the spin connection as a gauge field in Euclidean now, for the Lorentz tangent group, SOD, and the R-symmetry lives in some group G, well, the point is that these two groups should talk together in such a way that you can embed G in SOD and cancel this term. And this can be done in various cases. For example, the original one is back to 88, is the origin of the topological field theory. Witten showed that if you take any Euclidean form manifold and you have a theory which has at least n equal to 2 theory, you can always find a covariantly constant spinor and define supersymmetry in this way. This is called the topological twist. And the reason why it works is very simple. In four dimension, the tangent group is SO4, which is also SU2 times SU2, and the spinors are in representation of this tangent group, and if you take a spinor which transform in the representation, let me write better, in the representation of spin 1 half of the first SU2 and the representation 0 of the second one, and this is just a Weyl spinor in 4D, so if you try to solve this equation for a particular Weyl spinor, since the spinor is living only in a representation of SU2, this spin connection is actually restricted to the subgroup SU2 of SO4. So it's actually acting on the Weyl spinor, the spin connection is just in SU2, and they, luckily enough, they are symmetry of an n equal to 2 theory in 4 dimension contain an SU2 factor. So whatever is your spin connection, whatever is the gauge field that you get as a spin connection for your manifold, you can always turn on an equal gauge field in their symmetry in such a way that these two guys cancel. So you discover that if you have enough supersymmetry in 4 dimension, you can define a supersymmetric theory with this trick. This is the topological twist. Another obvious case where this works is 2 dimensions. These are indeed the cases where the topological field theory have been discussed more. In 2 dimensions, oh, sorry, this was D equal 4, I put it M4. In 2 dimensions, if you have a Riemann surface, the tangent group is very simple because the tangent group is SU2, which is U1, and if you have a theory with an R symmetry, which is at least U1, for example, if you have 2,2 supersymmetry, you have an R symmetry, which is U1, well, you can clearly identify any spin connection with a particular background of the R symmetry. So again, in 2 dimensions, you can always perform a topological twist. As I told you at the beginning of the lecture, these two cases have been studied in details in the last almost 30 years. They are very useful. Topological field theory are useful for geometrical questions. Essentially, the path integral computes the vacuum expectation value of observable computes invariance of the manifold, Donaldson invariance in 4 dimensions. And in the case of gauge linear sigma model in 2 dimension, you get invariance of the target space. If it is a Calabi-Yau, you get Gromov-Witten invariance. So this is the first case that has been discussed in the literature. Then let's have a look to the opposite, in a sense, situation where you have spheres. Spheres has become popular recently. And for spheres, you can do the following. There is another simple way of solving this equation. And this works even if you have no background for the asymmetry. So suppose that I set the A equal to 0. I just keep a non-trivial metric. And it's easy. I leave it as an exercise for you to check that if you can solve this equation, which is simpler than the one that I wrote, this is called the killing spinor equation. Then you solve also the more general one. Just a stupid exercise you plug in, and you discover that also the conformal killing equation is satisfied. Well, luckily enough, killing spinor exists, for example, on all spheres. Also, they exist essentially on Sasaki-Einstein manifold, more generally. Just to mention the case that appear in the string literature. But essentially, so if you have a sphere, it's very simple what you have to do. On a sphere, there is always a solution of this equation. You take it, and you can define the supersymmetric Lagrangian with no extra background.
Can I ask a question? So spin connection is torsion constraint?
That's the Riemannian spin connection. Oh. I'm taking Riemannian geometry here.
So in okay. this case, is it obvious that we can also always find a solution for A?
In which case? The
yes.
This one? Yeah, because if you choose a spinor that transforms only in the 1 half 0 representation of SO4, the components of the spin connection acting on the spinor living in the other factor are 0. So there are these components, but they don't act on my equation. So I just need to look at the part of the spin connection that lives in SU2. Maybe I said in a bad way before. Acting on a spinor in the 1 half 0 representation, I only need the SU2 part of the spin connection. And this I can cancel with an SU2 gauge field. Let me give you quickly another example. You can take, for example, and also this has been studied a lot in the literature, the case of product of this type. A sphere and a circle. Now here again you can check by yourself that if you take a spinor that satisfies the Killing equation on the sphere and you also turn on a component along the circle of the gauge of the R symmetry, essentially this should be imaginary and should have a constant part which is fixed by the equation, you can check that with these answers you can solve this equation here. Now, this case has been studied because it corresponds to something which is known as the superconformal index. And the superconformal index is essentially the following. It's a partition function on SD times S1. And since there is an S1 factor, this can always be written as a trace of minus 1 to the f, the fermionic number, times an exponential of essentially the anticommutator of a supercharge and a conformal supercharge, plus some extra stuff that correspond to fugacities for flavor symmetries. So this guy is a trace, so it counts the number of BPS states with sign of your conformal field theory. And this can be realized as a partition function. Now, now that you have your supersymmetric Lagrangian with this trick, so essentially you solve this equation, you couple to gravity, you freeze the gravity multiplet, and you get a Lagrangian which is supersymmetric. You can apply localization. Again, localization is a very old story. It's, in physics, go back again to the end of the 80s. There are again papers by Witten and other people. In mathematics, is something well known. There are many concepts of localization in mathematics. They look different, but at the end, they always compute essentially integrals or traces of this form here by reducing an integral of a differential form to the fixed point of some action on the manifold. And in physics, it works in the following way. I'm being very schematic because, again, I need to specify to write to put all the index in a correct way. I would need to specify dimension, type of spinors, and so on. So I'll be very schematic. I want a supersymmetric theory with a fermionic generator that square to zero, or more generally to a symmetry, bosonic symmetry G of your Lagrangian. Then the idea is that you take your action, or your Lagrangian, and you deform it in the following way. you add the transformation under the fermionic symmetry of a certain quantity that you are free to choose. You can also put an arbitrary parameter in front of it, thus getting a family of Lagrange. Since Q annihilates S because the original theory is supersymmetric, Q square is a symmetry. If I choose V invariant under the symmetry G, Q of ST will be still zero. So I'll be still writing a supersymmetric theory. And the idea is that even if I'm interested in the path integral for the original theory S, I can evaluate this family of path integral depending on T, simply because the derivative with respect to T of this object is zero. The reason is the following. If you plug this object here, the derivative with respect to T of z dt will bring down qv e to the minus st. So essentially, you will be computing the vacuum expectation value of the transformation of some observable. If this transformation q is a symmetry of your theory, this will be zero. Or you can also see the same, if you prefer, the same argument in another way, since st is invariant, this is the integral of q of something. And if you write explicitly the typical fermionic transformation, you discover that this q essentially acts on your path integral as a total derivative. So it's like integrating a total derivative. If you choose your v and s in a clever way, such that at infinity you have no boundary terms, the integral of a total derivative is zero. So even if I introduce the parameter t, the partition function is invariant under t. So what I can do is the following. Evaluate this partition function for very large t. For very large t, I can use the saddle point. So the saddle point approximation tells me that I need to find the minima of this this action and evaluate the action on the minima, and the other thing that remains to do in a saddle point approximation is to evaluate the determinant of fluctuation, and typically this will be written as a determinant, a denominator of bosonic fluctuation, and at the numerator, the determinant of the fermionic one, but if T is large enough, this will be an exact result. So if you are lucky, and you need many things to work, if you are lucky, you can find a clever V, it was arbitrary, such that this action is well-defined, positive, so bounded from below, and such that the classical solution, the minima of this action, are just few. Few in what sense? What happens typically is that when localization works, is that most of the integration, here you have a path integral integration, over all the fields in the Lagrangian, essentially the saddle points reduce this computation to a finite number of saddle point, or if infinite, a finite dimensional subspace of configuration, so that this integral, and I'll show you an example after the break, becomes something simple. So typically become the integration over few variables that are zero moles typically of the field configuration. So this is a finite dimensional integral of some integrand which contains the classical action and the determinant for the fermion, which will depend on the variable u. So essentially what localization does for you is to eliminate the integral over the fields, and you remain with a matrix model, essentially. If you are able to do that, well, matrix models are much better than path integrals, and you can explicitly evaluate the finite integral here. So typically, these guys, in most cases, live in the R-gauge variable, scalars, for example, that live in the Cartan of your gauge group. So if you have, for example, a UN gauge group, at the end you reduce all these guys here, essentially labels the eigenvalue of a UN matrix. So there are only n of them. This is a finite dimensional integral that you can hope to evaluate. Now, let me just tell you maybe one thing, and then we can stop for 5 minutes break. This is the general argument. It's simple. Obviously, nothing is so simple in life. So when you try to apply it, there are so many subtleties. The first one is that when you go to the Euclidean, you need to perform a continuation. And you know fermions are tricky. Because property of fermion in Lorentzian signature and Euclidean signature are different. So typically, to have consistent equation, most often you have to double the number of fermions. So you end up, I'll show you a Lagrangian at the beginning of next hour, you have to double the content, the fermionic content. Similarly, the bosonic content will be double because you don't impose, for example, any more reality condition. I'll show you a Lagrangian later. So what if before phi bar was the complex conjugate of phi, in the Euclidean they are independent variable. So you get a path integral on a too large manifold, and then you have to choose, essentially, because you want to evaluate what is supposed to be a weak rotated path integral, you have to choose a particular reality locus here. So there are many subtleties in this game. So, but maybe it's time to stop for 5 minutes, and after that I'll give you an example of how this this matrix model looks like.
Okay, thanks a lot.